Oh, thank you. Good catch. I'm going to go over this list real quick just to catch us back up on there. So we know that anger management is prevention for domestic violence. We teach the power and control wheel and what constitutes domestic violence. We teach family systems, and we teach fear, guilt, shame, the anger as a mask. We also do the shame tree and the roots of the bad fruit that we have in our life, as well as teaching timeout. Points of offenses, are we going to forgive or are we going to get bitter and walk in rage? And then the choice map about how we handle our attitude and what kind of choices we make through the day that changes us and puts us on the right pathway. Another thing I teach, which is not always easy for people to accept, is that you can't link your past experiences to your present behavior and find freedom at the same time. What I mean by that is that we have people who have been abused in childhood over here, and now they're beating their children over here. And they say to you, if you had been through all the things I've been through, you would be an alcoholic too, or you would be someone who beats their wife too, if you've been through what I've been through. And so their past experiences of childhood abuse or adverse impact that they've had in their life becomes an excuse for present behavior. What I tell people is at some point, you've got to break that link. You can't stay linked to the past, because one thing we cannot change is our past. We can't one day go, well, whatever happened there didn't happen. We're always going to have our past. And if it's an excuse for our behavior now, it will always be an excuse for our behavior. So that means we never have to change, because we're actually victims of our past. I say, if you're going to change your present behavior, you have to own it now. That means that whatever you do, you choose to do, and you have to own that. You might have grown up in a really bad home. Your parents may have been the worst parents ever known to man. You might have been raped, beaten, or whatever in your childhood. But you're the grown up now, and you get to choose what kind of life you're going to lead and what kind of behavior you're going to have. And so you have to own that, or you will never change. This is a really important counseling concept, is that you want to help people move past that. And so being molested as a child might be a good reason that you got into pornography or became promiscuous or began to see people as sexual objects. That might have been a good reason that you started, but it cannot become an excuse now to continue. Do you see what I'm saying? I'm not saying that it has no impact. I'm saying we want to therapeutically get people to the point where they have forgiven and repented and been delivered of those things that did occur in the past. And now they are free. I am a new creature in Christ. And I can do things different than they were done before. And so a lot of our learning now is, what does different look like? And so we have to learn what different looks like. I know I don't want to be this kind of parent, but what do I do instead? I know I don't want to treat my spouse this way, but where do I find the tools to do it different? That's what we do in counseling a lot, is we help people find those tools. So another thing we teach in anger management is called the think, feel, do cycle. The think, feel, do cycle. Let me show that to you. I want to teach all this stuff to all the stuff. I want to teach every lesson tonight to you because they're so good. I just don't have time. So think, feel, do. We start here with how we think. We have a thought. Our thought drives a feeling. That's wild. And then what we feel drives what we do. And then what we do changes what we think. This can be positive or negative. And so if it's positive, I just thought, wow, I can change this. And so, wow, I can change this. So then I begin to feel empowered, like I have power to change things. That's really great. So what do I do is I go to figure out how do I make change, and I take action steps to change. That's if you're having a positive thought. Now, if you're having a negative thought, it may look like I'm never going to make it. I'm never going to change. Which leads us to this feeling of being defeated, which leads to our behavior of justifying our poor behavior and not making a change. So it goes positive or negative. For those who wonder what CBT, cognitive behavioral change therapy, is, this is the crux of it right here. This is what it is. Think, feel, do. What I think changes how I feel changes what I do. And when I get that concept, I realize I can change the cycle. And so that's it. I have a whole class on that. We don't have time for it tonight. I know you've probably all seen the drama triangle. The drama triangle is another thing I teach in anger management. And that is a really powerful teaching. How many of you have seen the drama triangle? Oh, you haven't seen it. You've seen it, Crystal? Not sure?
It's been a long time, but it sounds familiar. Very familiar. Yeah.
Well, these are important counseling concepts when you're looking at helping people with relationships. So I'm going to just show it to you real quick because I can't help myself. In the drama triangle, we always have a victim. And we always have a persecutor. And we always have a rescuer. So the victim has felt victimized by something someone else did. They have a relationship. The victim runs to someone who cares about them, and they tell them the story of what happened to them and how bad this persecutor really is. And so the rescuer begins to turn on the persecutor for being a persecutor. The victim joins with the rescuer, and these two now are mad and hateful toward the persecutor, which in turn makes the persecutor become a victim. The rescuer has now become a persecutor, and the victim has become the rescuer. Because these two have a relationship. And when this rescuer starts persecuting the persecutor, the victim will come to the rescue and say, "See, I'm nice to you. I love you. I'm better than this. you should be with me. And then they both turn against the rescuer, who's now the persecutor, and that person is now becoming the victim. And it goes around and around and around. And so this is this foundation of conflict. Whenever people can go to somebody else and get them on their side, they are perpetrating the drama triangle. And whenever you take someone's side against another person, you are involved in that drama triangle. You may think you're helping because they need you and they came to you for help, and you just happen to be right there to take their side and help them. But you're not actually helping if you're not turning back to the victim and asking them what they are going to do about it. So if someone's being a victim and I say to them, oh, so your wife said all these really mean things to you? How could she? How dare she? What a horrible person. I've just been the rescuer who's joined with the victim against someone. But if the victim comes to me and says, my husband said all these things, these are horrible, he's a mean, awful man, and I say, what are you going to do about it? What do you think would be a good idea? Do you need counseling? Do you guys need to find some help? Here's a hotline number. But you throw the ball back to the victim and say, ball's in your court. If you've become a victim of something in your home, you have to find a solution. And I, as your rescuer, will support your solution, but I will not be your solution. People who become a solution for other people get their value from being needed. And they, as long as there's a victim, they will always have a job. As long as they have a job, they're going to feel like their life is worth living, right? And so each person in the drama triangle gets something out of this. And so that's another thing we teach all day.
Could you say that again?
As long as each person gets something out of the position they're in, they won't want to change it. The victim, for instance, gets something out of being a victim. What do they get?
Sympathy,
care, attention, things they've wanted. If you're a rescuer, what do you get out of it? Value, worth. I'm needed. I'm somebody's solution. They need me. I have to be there for them. So I find worth and value for my life. The persecutor, what do they get out of it? A sense of power and control. So everybody derives something out of their scenario. And if we can't see that, then we can't help them get out of it. If you watch every conflict you get into, you have the possibility of repeating this pattern, because I find it in almost every conflict, actually. It's hard to not go to someone who will take your side. When you know, if I go talk to my mom, she always told me I wasn't supposed to marry you. And here I am talking to my mom, telling her how awful you are, and she's agreeing with me because she knew I should never have married you to begin with. And so what we've done is we've made mom the rescuer, and she has told me everything I feel is right, and that you're a beast. And so this goes on and on. Does that make sense? And the roles keep changing constantly. It's a trap. It's a trap. Mm-hmm. But it's a hard one to get out of. It's a hard one to stay out of if you can't see it. And so we teach people how to see it when it's happening.
But it is interesting, Teresa, when you do say, what will you do?
Uh-huh.
And you get it back to them, how it stops that whole cycle.
Yeah, because
and at first they're not they're not used to it. The victim is not used to it.
Uh-huh. You're right about that, Lisa. It's like, what? You're throwing the ball in the court. In my court, didn't you see I was helpless? Didn't you see I came to you for help? And now you're telling me there's something I have to do? You know, it doesn't seem fair. It doesn't seem right. How can I be a victim like this? We're pulling people out of that victim mentality because many people have lived their life like this. They don't know that there's something wrong with it. It's that you've got to see it.
Yeah.
It's not to condemn, it's to set free.
Right. So, Teresa, do you see where the victim then no longer goes to that person, maybe goes to another person?
If they
want to stay a rescuer?
If they want to stay a victim, that's exactly what they do.
Yeah.
And they think, oh my gosh, you know, I didn't rescue you and now you're mad at me. Well, counselors, guess what? People are going to get really mad at you if you're a really good counselor. You have to get over your people pleasing altogether to be a counselor. Because you have to be able to speak the truth that sets people free without compromise. And they don't always like it. It doesn't always feel good. That doesn't mean your clients are all going to hate you. We have clients that love us all our lives. But there are those special people that didn't really come in for help. They came in so you would rescue them. They want you to tell them what to do. They want you to tell them the solution. They want you to be the person they can run to. You can stay. You're welcome. Do you see what I'm saying? Counselors are in a unique position for that to happen. And so as a counselor, you have to be very careful not to fall into this drama and into this trap. The other thing we teach is the stages of change. That for people to change, there are certain stages every person goes through. And the first stage of change is called pre-contemplation. The pre-contemplation stage of change. This is when I'm thinking about change. Like, gee, I tied one on last night. I've been sick all day. I do this all the time. Maybe I should change. But that's all they think. That's where they stay. Or the next stage of change is called contemplation change, stage of change. I'm moving from saying I probably should change to I want to change. I don't want to be like this anymore. I don't want to live like this. And then they move through that contemplation stage and they say, I think I can change. And that's still in that contemplation stage, but you're moving through that stage to the next stage, which is called the planning stage. In the planning stage, I think I can change, and now I'm looking for recovery programs. Now I'm looking for a counselor. Now I'm looking for someone to tell me maybe how I could do it. And so now I'm starting to plan. Alcoholics begin to think about where are the latest 12-step programs? Where is the best counselor in town? How can I get into a DBT course or whatever? Then they start planning and they call and they make arrangements to meet with someone. And they talk to the person who's a part of the 12-step program or the counselor or the pastor or whoever they go to. And now they leave that place saying, I know I can change. I know I can do it. And then they go to the action stage of change. This is where they take the planning things, they realize what they can do, and they begin to put it in action. The thing they say then is, I can do this and I will do this. So if it's an alcoholic, they're working on stop drinking. If it's a workaholic, they're working on learning to recreate. If it's, you know, a food issue, you know, overeating, undereating, they're working on that. I used the stages of change when I worked as a hospice social worker for people who didn't want to leave their home and go into a nursing facility. We would use these stages of change. But the action stage says, I am willing and I will do it. The next stage says, I have done it. I am doing it. And they move into the new stage called maintenance. So I haven't been drinking for a year, or I've really got my program going, been doing it for 3 to 6 months. And now I'm going to have a plan for how I'm going to maintain my stand, my sobriety, or whatever it is. And so I have a plan of maintenance so that I don't relapse. It's during the maintenance stage of change that people relapse. Now, there are many drug and alcohol programs that teach relapse is a part of recovery. And that helps people who are relapsing for sure. So we tell people you don't really lose clean time, you just get back up and keep going. So you went on a binge for the weekend. The weekend's over, get back on the horse and ride. Don't just fall back into failure. In 12-step programs, you lose all your clean time and you're starting over. I actually don't really accept that myself because it's so disheartening. Any thoughts on any of that? The stages of change. I also think recovery takes more than 12 steps, by the way, so I'm not going to get into that discussion. If a 12-step program works for someone, I want to encourage them and inspire them to go. But I'm going to tell you, some people need a whole lot more than 12 steps to heal. Because sometimes it takes years. Sometimes it takes a long, long time. And then we also teach on disorders and diagnoses. Anger can also come from a diagnosis. If you know children with attention deficit disorder, they tend to escalate into anger very quickly. This is part of something they can't help. This is organic in them. They have emotion regulation issues. And that's part of their disorder. So we want them in programs like DBT to help them get that emotion regulation under control if they're mature enough to do it. And then the last day of the program is statement of responsibility. Because my program doesn't really have a last day, we just keep going over and over. When people sit down with me and they want to graduate the program, I ask them to write a statement of responsibility. In the statement of responsibility, they are stating what they are responsible for that brought them into anger management, and what plan they have when they leave anger management to make sure that they don't fall back into those old patterns. What plan do they have? And who are their support people? And we call that a statement of responsibility. Responsibility meaning I'm responsible for my anger. I'm responsible for what I did with my anger. And I am responsible to make sure I keep my anger under control now. So that's basically the 16 weeks of our anger management program here at GSM. I don't stay in the program all the time. If I learn new things I think are going to be helpful to the class, I may bring it in and introduce that too. It's not a rigid outline of anger management, but it shows you the kind of things that need to be covered in anger management. Any thoughts?
Losing your clean time or not losing your clean time. I found that interesting just because I don't know which way, how I feel about it exactly. I mean, I've always kind of felt like somebody relapses, they shouldn't go all the way back to the beginning. but at the same time, it's like there needs to be something that's a consequence kind of. And I don't know how to reconcile those.
I hear what you're saying, Lorna, because relapse, if that takes us back to the beginning, you can totally lose heart and not get back up again.
Yeah.
That's what I've actually noticed with some people. But not all people. And I guess what really matters is what works for them.
Yeah.
Is it helpful for you to know that you've lost that time? Or is it helpful for you to know you can get back up and keep going? And we're not taking anything away from you. So I don't know that you always need consequence when you are already condemned and guilty and ashamed because of something you've done. You're kind of self-punishing.
Yeah, the trick is the shame, whether it's shame or guilt. And it's like, if you've already got shame, then nothing's going to make it worse. And
shame isn't helpful, actually. Yeah,
that doesn't fix anything. And so it'd be better to just like, you know, it's okay, go on, continue on. Don't let this put you.
I tell people, you're a grown up. You can live any way you want to. You chose to recover, and I stand with you. But you still get to choose how you live when you walk out of this office. I'm not your mama.
Choose a life
recovery or not. You know? Yes, Rich.
Do you teach them what to do after they realize they screwed up? Like they had an anger outburst, how to fix that or make it better? So how to recover out of that kind of thing?
Yeah, what I will do with people is say, okay, so you blew up at your wife and you said some really cruel things. Number one, how can you fix that? How can you repair what got done there? And two, if this happened again, what are some tools that you could use this time instead of blowing up? What could you do different? So we go through this exercise called... I forgot the name of it, but it's kind of a, you know, the outline of a blow up. What happened first? What happened then? What did you do? And then we go back. If this happened again, what could you do? What is your plan? What will you do? And then they have an action plan. So you work through it. And you're trying to remind people of the tools they've learned and the skills that they actually do have so that they're not just left with this condemnation and this shame, but they now have a way out. They have a way of learning something new. And yeah. I always look at failure as an opportunity to learn. And I know that we say words like that, but then we go punishing people when they do bad.
Yeah.
But actually, we're grown-ups. We don't need to be punished. We need to learn. Yeah. And that's a hard concept in a culture where everything you do got punished.
Uh-huh.
And we see that they need punishment again. Even though there's some people who do best that way, it's a cruel teacher if you always have to be punished and you can't learn from experience.
One other thing is, it seems like if you have we all get angry, we all get pissed off at stuff, you know, and how we react to it. There might be a consistent thing that we get angry at. It might be a person. If it's a person, is it worthwhile trying to educate the person about what you're trying to do to yourself to improve? Like, hey, I'm taking this class, I'm learning this stuff, I'm making some improvements. Or is it best just to do it in private and just not even deal with talking to anybody about that?
It depends. It always depends on the circumstances and the person and what they're going through. So you have to look at each case separately. There isn't really a pat answer for what needs to happen for each person. It really depends where they're at, what's going on, what's worked for them and what hasn't. So you have to kind of do the case study of the individual. We really, there are no pat answers that work for any circumstance. We're just all so different. What works for one does not work for another.
So I thought of one thing that the relapse thing is sort of like, I guess, that when I first learned that I was being codependent, I learned about what it meant, which I didn't have a clue. And then, and so I got better at recognizing it, and I would recognize it after I did it. And then I would recognize it while I was doing it. And then I came to a point where I could actually stop myself before I did it. But that took a, you know, a few years.
Yeah.
It wasn't just a easy process. And so I would think it would be similar that, you know, you have to train yourself. And the relapse thing is like, well, I did it again, but, you know, maybe I recognized it sooner, or, you know, maybe I recognized it as I was doing it, or, you know, that it's a process, not just like you're either sober or not sober. You know, you're either with it, with a lot of things, they're not as cut and dry as alcohol or not alcohol.
Yeah, you're right, Lorna. It really, that's why it's so individual.
Yeah. You know,
change does take time. You know, it's easy for me to go through the steps of contemplation, stage of change, and then action. But sometimes that may take 6 months to move from one stage to another stage. It's not an easy fix or a fast fix. Motivational interviewing is something I really encourage you to look up on YouTube, because motivational interviewing techniques help people move through stages of change. And it tells you what kind of questions to ask and what kind of attitude to have to help people move through stages of change. The technique is called motivational interviewing. And you can see examples of it on YouTube. And there's some really good skits, some really good ones to show you how to help people move through the stages of change. I want to move now to the man in the box training, because this is something that you can use with your families. And the man in the box is an anger management training. It's also a domestic violence skill to learn. So I just drew a box here. And what I'm going to ask everyone to do is to tell me words that define what it means to be a real man. If you're a real man, then what kind of man are you? What are the traits? So you might put things like protective. Men are protectors. Or you may say they're providers. What else are they? What makes a man a real man? In your eyes.
Honest.
Mm-hmm. Honest. What else? Are they strong or weak?
Strong.
Men are strong. Are they decision makers?
Yes.
Yeah. Decisions are made by the men often. What else do we know about men?
Faithful.
Faithful. Faithful. What else makes a man a man?
Compassionate.
These aren't usually words we find being given in our batter's intervention, by the way. In anger management and batter's intervention, we often hear a lot of macho words given what a man is. Can you think of some of those words that we used to use to define men?
Confident.
Confident, yeah. What else?
Tough.
What?
Tough.
Tough. They're strong and they are tough. Are they in charge or are they dependent?
In charge.
Yeah, they would be independent, right?
Powerful.
Powerful.
Fearless.
Fearless, yeah. And what about head of their house? Right? Head of the home?
Always right.
Always. That was spoken by a man, by the way. Always right. So when we look at men and we see this profile, we also recognize that there are men who do not fit this profile, right? What would we say about men who really are not what we would consider good men? We might think of them as lazy, right?
Liars.
Liars.
Manipulative.
Manipulative.
Weak.
Weak.
Untrustworthy.
Untrustworthy.
Rude.
Rude.
Abusive.
Abusive.
Undependable.
Undependable. How about fearful?
Coward, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And what about being dependent on others for help? Dependent on my wife who's working. So then if we see men like this that are weak and lazy, dependent, they're fearful, they're rude and abusive, what do we call these kind of men?
Scumballs.
That's right. Scumballs, which is a nice word compared to some of the others.
Loser.
Loser. What?
Beta male.
Beta male.
A what?
A beta male. What else do we call these men?
Starts with an A, but.
That's even mild compared to many things I've heard.
Yeah, I'm sure.
The A word. We could call them mama's boys, right? They're dependent. No.
Yeah.
We have all kinds of names, actually, and these are all the nicest ones I've probably ever heard during this exercise. When men feel like this, like they are, when they find themselves out of work, unemployed, unable to provide, dependent on their wife to meet their needs, they have these thoughts in their head, like, I'm just a loser, I'm a scumbag, I can't get it together, kinds of names I call myself. And what then do they feel? What does that feel like? We got a whole bunch of people right now unemployed, finding themselves in this position. What are they going through? What are they feeling?
Probably all four of those emotions you listed on the other previously, the fear, the pain, the guilt, the shame.
Fear, pain, guilt, shame. What else? What else?
Maybe desperate.
What's that? Desperate?
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, desperate.
Unworthy.
Unworthy. Many feel very lonely and very isolated. Isolation. Yeah. So all these feelings are going on, and they're not fitting what they would consider what it means to be a real man. They're not fitting that. And now they're feeling all these feelings. So what do they do? Well, some turn to pornography or adultery. Some turn to alcohol. Some men become violent. What else? What do they do? What do people do when they have these sort of hopeless, worthless feelings?
Have affairs.
Yeah, adultery. Because it makes them feel more like a man. Maybe right?
Suicidal.
Some may be suicidal. What else?
I think a lot of them are trying to become numb because they know that if they become sensitive to people, they get their ass kicked every time. And so they, at least they feel that way. So they just have to stop it because no one's gonna, our society isn't ready to hear them be weak.
Yep, some of them stuff it and some become numb. Some go into video games and they don't come out. And there's a whole bunch of these guys now, right? They go into fantasy about when they actually were doing better and feeling better. So a lot of people don't understand the makeup of, and this is man in the box. We're going to switch and do woman in the box in a minute, but a lot of people don't understand what's driving their anger. What's driving their addictions? What's driving their behavior? You can do this exercise with your clients. You can draw a box and say, what does perfect life look like to you? What are you supposed to look like right now? What do you think the best you should be? And then let's see what's not working. And so we're looking for those outside the box behaviors, thinking, feeling, doing. You see the feeling, doing. We want people to put together the understanding of their own life and their own behavior. And this is an exercise that we can use to help people to understand where their greatest pain and disappointment comes from. And why they're now turning to alternative ways of living, getting back into old behaviors. Or starting new behaviors. right now we have more people out of work than we've had in a long time. And I'm seeing a lot of increase in pornography, sex trafficking. I've talked to two pastors in the last 5 months that have gotten caught up in buying prostitutes, got busted publicly, and they're trying to piece their lives back together. They didn't understand what happened until we went through this exercise and said, let's take a look. Let's look at what happened. Let's see where this all began for you. Because they need healing and they've got to get well, because they still are pastors and their congregation is totally unaware of what's happening with them. And they're continuing in their ministry, but their ministry will be definitely changed by this thought. They've got to find their way back out of it. Does that surprise you?
No.
That one day that might be one of your clients?
I think that's a good thing to look at.
Yeah, because people are just people and are just people everywhere. It doesn't matter what their position in life. What matters is they came to us and they asked for help, and we want to have tools to be able to help them. All right, ladies, let's take a look at Lady in the Box. When I do this in Batterer's Intervention and we look at what a perfect woman is supposed to be like, it's very unique. Because many of the men in Batterer's Intervention will say the perfect wife is a perfect homemaker. She's a caregiver, a nurturing mother. What else? What do you think of when you think of what it really means to be a great woman?
A good parent. A good parent.
A good parent. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Woman, look up Proverbs 31.
Well, that ain't a real chick.
A woman who's confident.
Confident. Mm-hmm.
Feminine.
Feminine, yeah. What else?
Understanding.
Understanding.
Compassionate. How about
compassionate? Yeah.
What did you say?
Compassionate was the last one.
Oh.
And then understanding, compassionate.
Somebody that likes sex. Somebody that is there for their man. I don't know if that's appropriate or not, but.
Yeah, there for their man, yeah. There for the man.
Mm-hmm. Multitasker.
What? A
multitasker.
Yeah, multitasker. Especially these days.
Loyal.
Loyal. Social. Kind.
A good cook.
Yes, got to be a good cook. What else?
Affectionate.
Affectionate, yeah. Got to be affectionate. What What else?
An azer.
A what?
An azer. Somebody that's from creation, Adam and Eve. The woman is the helpmate, the one who stands up for her family.
Ah.
Mama Bear.
Ah. Protective. So all these things have been used to define women through the years. And that whole Proverbs 39 thing, I just got to tell you, that is a mother telling a son what she wants his wife to be. And I promise you, if your mother-in-law could put in an order like that, she would have done that for her little boy. It's not a real woman. Thank you, Jesus, God. My husband one time said to me, Teresa, I want us to read the Proverbs 31 woman. I was like, all right. Because it's Mother's Day. And he says, so he reads the whole thing. And he says to me, so how do you think you line up? And I said, well, I think I'm only missing one thing here. And he said, really? What do you think you're missing? And I said, servant girls. I don't have any servant girls. He said, well, you have a washer and a dryer and a dishwasher. Different thing. Anyway, so here we have the perfect woman, kind of the profile of what we think of womanhood. But what happens when you're outside the box? These words do not define you. Can you think of women that we don't maybe appreciate outside that box? We don't think of women as mechanics, for instance, or hardworking. I didn't see any of that on here.
Intelligent.
Domineering.
Though we've all met some. What else?
Independent. Controlling.
Controlling, independent. Independent. Controlling. What else?
Entrepreneurial.
Maybe entrepreneurial.
These are bad things about women, correct? Or
just women are kind of outside the box of your normal woman that we think of as the perfect woman, with all these sweet, sensitive, kind, and gentle, and you know, loyal and compassionate, there for her man. A homemaker, a caregiver. We think of feminine, we think of these women. And then we have, you know, we have women who are outside of that box, who are out making money, entrepreneurial, starting businesses, contracting, hardworking. Maybe they're mechanics, but.
Or hard driven, or, you know, what is it when they want to work all the time? Type A personality.
Oh, that might be me. I don't know. Type A.
Moneymaker.
The provider. The protector. So what happens to, what do we call women that fit this profile? They're more independent and strong, and they're hardworking and controlling and domineering and entrepreneurial, and they're the provider and the protector. What kind of words do we think of when we think of those chicks?
It's that B word. It's interesting that the guys get the A word and the women get the B word.
Only from you, Lorna.
Yeah.
These women are often single.
Yeah, I was going to say single.
Some are single, some are not. Yeah. What else?
Ball busters.
Ball busters. We're getting there. What else?
Again, they're lonely, just like men.
That's feeling. We're not looking for feelings. We're looking for thoughts. What do we think of these women? What do we call them in our mind? Say it out loud, of course.
Gay,
maybe. What else?
Tough or tomboy?
Tomboy.
Oh, that's good.
So when you find yourself in this position where you have to go out and work because no one's going to make a living for you, and you have to be the one who's in control and the one who has enough intelligence to make enough money to make the things happen, because you're married to someone who got laid off last year and can't get back to work, and yet you're out busting your balls, right? That's a ball buster. And you feel this way. You feel like you're just, kind of doing the guy's thing. And people are thinking you're gay, and they're watching you. And it's like, you have feelings about that, right? What does it feel like when these words are going through your mind about you, ladies? What's the feeling?
Sad.
Or maybe
tired.
Sad, tired for sure.
Misunderstood.
Misunderstood is a huge word right there. That's probably the biggest feeling right there, is people don't understand, which makes you feel alone, right? And brings you back to that isolated feeling.
And if it's prolonged, you can feel hopeless.
You can begin to feel hopeless.
You can feel frustrated.
Frustrated. And rage. We can feel a lot of rage. A lot of anger. A lot of pain. So, here comes the $1 million question. The $1 million question is, when I'm feeling all these feelings, what do I do? What do women do when they're caught in this trap and they're feeling lonely and isolated, hopeless and frustrated, sad and tired and deeply misunderstood? What do they do about that?
Eat.
Yeah, many eat
drugs and alcohol for women too.
Others drink, and one of the things that might be surprising to the men but not to the women is women get caught up in pornography as much as men do. They can be addicted to porn.
I would think that for a personality that's hard driven and maybe competitive, entrepreneurial, they might turn to something like exercise to an extreme.
Oh, extreme exercise, yeah. That is more of what a woman would do than a man would do, right? What else would a woman do?
Shopping.
What? Oh.
Maybe overworking, right?
Mm-hmm.
Trying to find value and worth in my life through something that I do. What else? What do women do?
Isolate.
They isolate.
They also can get really super involved with their kids.
Yep, they can live through their. They also go into deep depression. Some struggle with anxiety. There's those feelings of never being enough or being able to live up to what everybody thinks I'm supposed to be can sometimes be very overwhelming.
They might also try to do it all, like try to do the work thing and all the home stuff, trying to do both roles.
Doing it all. They want to do it all. I run actually into more women who do it all than the others. When you have women coming into your office and they're caught in some kind of addiction or issues like these, they need to begin to understand their own life. And we need to begin to talk to them about maybe their expectations of themselves is wrong or too high. And maybe they have been thinking they were supposed to be something they're just not. And maybe this outside the box requires us to remove the box, right? Because if we remove the box and we don't put people in a box, then they're free to be who they are and cope in the best ways they know how. And we begin to find compassion for ourselves again. What do you think about that?
Do the guys get to remove the box too?
Exactly. Yeah, it's actually, when this training came about, it was all for men. There were no women in the room. But I think women and men need to look at this stuff equally and look at it together. Because we fall into the trap of certain things, certain behaviors, and we don't know why. We don't understand. But if you were to go through this exercise with your clients, they would begin to understand themselves a little bit better.
So can I ask you a quick question, Teresa?
Yes.
So when we're talking about the in the box and the outside the box and everything, are these the people in these women's lives, like the husband, or are they just society in general or their own perspective of what it is, do you think?
It's all of us, actually, because okay. You do this exercise for yourself, right? You could draw a box and you could look at what you expect of yourself. What is perfect in your life? And in what ways do you not live up to your own expectations?
Oh, that makes sense.
What do you think about yourself when that happens? You know, what kind of thoughts do you have? Do you self-deprecate? Do you hate yourself? Are you mad at yourself? Do you not give yourself any grace? So what kind of names are you hearing in your head about yourself? And what are you actually feeling? What's going on? What are you feeling? Are you defeated? Are you feeling hopeless? Are you isolated or alone? And when you get that way, what do? What is your go-to when life is too painful? Right? So it could be anybody and everybody. You could do this exercise for yourself. When I teach it in the anger management, I have everybody go home and make their own box and go through this exercise and look at, are they really hard on themselves? Are they really hard on the women in their life or the men in their life? Because a lot of times, a lot of the conflict between men and women is we have these unrealistic expectations of what the other is supposed to be. And they don't live up to it. And we have all kinds of thoughts about them, about that. We call them lots of names in our mind. And we punish people particularly in marriage. I find that people who are married somehow think the other person has to line up to their expectations. That other person has to be what they want them to be. And they're not. They're just not. We have a huge problem with divorce in our country. But more than that now is people aren't even bothering to get married.
Yeah.
That's why our divorce rate has dropped so low, is because people just aren't getting married. Because they're afraid that they're not going to be able to be enough and be faithful and stay in a marriage. What are you thinking over there, John? Haven't heard from you yet.
There we go.
Yep, we got you.
Yep. So a lot of this anger, though, I think is, especially in marriage, is that all these expectations you have, well, the other person has no idea that you have that expectation.
That's the truth.
And so then it comes out as anger because you don't have your expectations aren't met.
Mm-hmm.
And so to get back in control, you think that you need to be angry that you're back in control, when in fact it's the opposite.
Ah.
I think.
I love that you brought up expectations that are not spoken, unspoken expectations. I think we all have those unspoken expectations. And in this kind of exercise, you could actually use it to examine the expectations, right? I mean, you could say, let's put our expectations of the husband in the box. And let's put the expectations he has for his wife in the box. So I did something with my husband years ago. We went through kind of a tough spell. If you're married, you will. If you haven't yet, you have time. But we went through a little rough spell. My husband went to Bible college against my will. He wanted to go into the ministry, and I did not want to go in the ministry. That did not look very fun to me. But he was convinced that he needed to do it. We had three little kids, and I was really concerned about that. The years in college, when you have three small kids, you're going to be missing years of their life. I was very concerned about a lot of things. We had been married 8 years at that point. Maybe closer to 4 or 5 years. But he went to Bible college, and in the last year of Bible college, I had been single parenting for 4 or 5 years. He had been working a full-time job, going to school full-time, doing homework every night. We didn't see him very much, and I was pretty mad. I was not happy. And one day I was sitting in church. Oh, and he was pastoring a church at the same time. And I was sitting in church in the back row, and I asked the Lord, I said, God, this is my anniversary, and he doesn't remember. And what are you going to do? I asked the Lord specifically, how are you going to fix this? How are you going to heal us? And I opened a notebook and I started writing down everything I heard. And it's the most amazing thing. I wrote down seven things, seven steps I heard. And at the end of the service, I said to my girlfriend who was sitting next to me, I said, will you take my kids for the day? And she said, absolutely, I'll take your kids for the day. And I said, great. And I walked up to my husband. I said to him, you're with me today. And I took him by the tie and I led him to my car. And we got in the car. We had $7 to our name at that point, which was another issue. And we start driving. We lived right outside Eugene. We lived in Dexter. We were pastoring a church in a little town. And so I started driving toward the coast. I did not know where I was going. But I said to him, the Lord has told me to do this specific thing. So the first thing I'm going to ask you to answer for me is, when you got married, what did you think it would be like? What was your expectation of what marriage would look like? And when you're done, I'll tell you what I thought marriage would look like. And so we began to talk about that first question. What were we hoping for? What did we think it would look like? So we both talked about that, and then I stopped at a little 7-Eleven and I bought a little loaf of bread and a small bottle of wine. And we went and found a little cliff, a very private little cliff. And I took the blanket out of my trunk and a notebook that I had had at church. And we went and we sat over that cliff. We just sat looking in that little alcove. And we had to answer the next question. And the next question is, are you the person you were hoping to be at this point in your life? Are you the father, the husband that you pictured when we got married? Am I the wife or the mother, the person I thought I would be when I got married? And we talked about, we didn't get to point at each other. We had to look only at ourselves. And we began to talk honestly about, no, I'm not the husband I wanted to be. I'm tired and I'm lonely and I've been working really hard. And I'm disappointed. And I was able to say, well, I'm really a mad woman. I'm very angry that I've done this alone and that you have not been with me through this process of raising our kids. It pisses me off that you come in and you get to be Disneyland dad. And I feel like I'm the bitch of the family. So I'm the one who makes everything line up. Like, wow, I didn't know you felt that way. That's really tough. And then the next thing on the list was we were to sit back to back and write each other a letter and explain to each other what we like about the other person, what we see in the other person. So we're sitting back to back and now we got to be nice. And I began to write to my husband and I said, I do appreciate your faithfulness to me. I've never worried that there would be another woman in your life. I've never worried about that ever, not one time. And I really appreciate that when you started college, that you stuck with it and you are faithful to finish what you start. As hard as it's been, that dedication is to be commended. I wrote 2 pages of things I loved about my husband. And he wrote a page or two about what he loved about his wife. And then we turned around and we read it to each other. I read to him my letter and he read to me his letter. And the letter so softened our hearts and reminded us of who we are and why we love each other. And so we repented. Each one of us had to just repent to the other for what we had become and how disappointed we had become. And after our repentance, we broke the bread. And we had communion. We dedicated our lives back to serving Christ with each other and in each other again. And then we each took a drink of the wine and we laid hands on each other and we prayed for each other. And I'm going to tell you something. Our marriage was totally healed that day. We came home different people. We were together again. We were united again. We were healed. And I will never forget that event in my life. I wrote it down. I've kept it, that journal. And I thought to myself, now and again, we need to do something like that again. Just to remember and just to do it. When God tells you what to do, if you can be open to hearing that voice, he knows how to heal you. He knows what you need. We don't know what we need. I didn't know when I drug him into that car, even where we were going. But I knew God told me those 7 steps I had to take with Patrick. And God healed us. You're going to be working with a lot of people who need healing in their life. And maybe you need some healing in your life. And when you ask God, God, what are you going to do? How are you going to fix this? He hears that heart cry. He hears that heart cry. And he will meet you there. And that's what we want to teach our clients. What this has to do with anger management is so much, right? Because as long as we stay blaming each other and mad at each other, unable to do those steps that I just told you, then the anger is going to always be present. We have to somehow allow the Lord back into the relationship. And we have to allow the healing to happen. What are some of your thoughts and reactions? Questions, whatever.
Have you ever used that technique in counseling about having them write a letter to each other and read it?
I have. It's been a while since I've done it, and just talking about it tonight reminded me of it. Yeah, I actually did do that a couple of times. I had it actually work really well. But you have to be sensitive. Is that what God is saying right now? Because some people are up for that and some people are not up for that. It depends on where you're at. So you want to hear that from the Lord. But it's a great exercise. It's a great thing to do. I thought it was important to talk about tonight because we see so many families falling apart right now. So many marriages are just not making it. And people blame each other. And one of the things that we do in anger management is that we always talk about, what is my part? What is my side of the street? People cannot come in and lambast their spouse that is not with them. I always say, oh, well, she's not here tonight, so let's talk about your part of the fight. Because we can't fix her. She's not here. We've got you. So let's talk about what you did, what you said, what you felt, what was going on in your life. And what you could actually be doing now. And so I never allow blame to shift to another. When we allow someone to blame the other for all the problems, we are creating that victim mentality. And we're compassionate people. We try to let people off the hook. We try to spare them. We try to rescue them. And I don't do any of those things. And we can't do it. In anger management, we cannot rescue. And we cannot help people feel better. You've got to be willing to have angry people be angry. You've got to be willing to be kind of that person who has maybe a harder word than people want to hear. Because if you're going to save their lives, they have to get real. It can't be a game. They can't come in with a certain set of behaviors, leave with those same behaviors and think they've changed. It doesn't work that way. How many of you want to do an anger management class? I invite you in to see mine, to work in mine a little bit and see how we handle the group, because the group dynamics is really important in anger management. People in the group do try to counsel each other and we say, no, you can't be counseling. There's no fixing anybody here. Nobody's going to fix anybody here. Now, I had a man come in about a month or two ago and he said, Teresa, tonight I'm really angry and I'm wondering if I can just kind of let it out here. And what did I do? I looked around at the whole group and I said, are you up for that? Or should I say no? And everybody in the group said, no, he can tell us what's going on. Go ahead, go off. And boy, he went off. And he just went off about his job and losing his home and all these things that were going to happen to him. And he took about 5 minutes, which is what I gave him. I said, you can go for 5 minutes. You got to be done. But the group agreed. That was a group agreement that he could do that. For being a group of angry people, this is a very happy group. We laugh, we talk, we cry. We go through a lot of things together, but it's a very tight-knit group. Anybody's welcome to walk in and they become tight-knit all of a sudden. But we get well. We work on getting well together. Anger is an emotion. It is not a sin. Anger is an emotion. It's not a sin. The Bible says, be angry, but sin not. In other words, you can get mad at your spouse, but you may not beat them up. Right? You can get mad at the bank, but you can't throw a tantrum in the bank. What are you going to do with this anger? What are you going to do with it? We talk a lot about road rage, things like that in anger management. Anger management is dear to me. It is the thing we talk about and we teach about. What constitutes domestic violence? We get into lots of discussions about that. There borders on domestic violence. You put your hands on someone's neck, it's an instant felony. We share stories about risking so much in our anger. And we talk about what is the high cost of anger? What has your anger actually cost you? Because people that are in anger management usually have done something that has hurt them. Now, people come into anger management to con me all the time. They're court ordered to come in and they say they're not court ordered. They need a letter proving that they've been here, but it's not for the court, it's for their girlfriend. I actually know the scoop here. It's like, all right, you can con me for a minute if you want to, it's your life. But I know the games that are being played. I know what's going on. So it's like, be angry, do not sin. Do not lose your testimony. Your testimony of being a godly person is very important. How many agree with that? Yeah. Did I tell you the story about when I broke down on Highway 58? About the little man, the tow truck driver. Did I tell you about that?
I heard it.
You heard that one?
Yeah, it's a good one. Tell it again.
Well, it's a good story about anger management because every opportunity for anger was there with me. And what happened is I was driving home from Klamath Falls to Portland and I break down on the side of the road. It's dark, just getting dark. I'm in the middle of the mountains. I am not close to a community or a town, probably 7 or 8 miles out of Chemult, up on the mountain. And I sit at the side of the road and I'm not sure what to do. I have no cell phone coverage. I have no working car and I'm just sitting there. And I'm thinking, God, bring the right people to me and don't let me get hurt here. Because I'm a woman sitting alone on the side of the road. Well, pretty soon an ODOT truck comes by and the lady comes out and she says, what's going on? I said, my car just broke down. I don't have cell phone coverage. I don't know what to do. And she said, can I get you a tow truck? And I'm thinking, I don't want a tow truck. But then I thought, what else would I do? I need a tow truck. So I said, yes, you can get me a tow truck. About 45 minutes later, I hear a tow truck coming and I hear it coming. It's going clunk, 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 clunk. And up drives this old tow truck. And I thought I should be pulling it because it was old, dilapidated, dirty tow truck. Anyway, this little man gets out of the tow truck, walks over to my car. I roll down my window. He is covered in grease, covered like he's just crawled out from under a car he was working on. He probably did, but he was just covered in grease and dirt and he smiled and his teeth were all black and broken. And he goes, what'd you do to your car? I said, well, I drove it. He goes, flip the hood. So I flip the hood, he goes and looks at it. He comes back and he goes, yeah, broke it. That's what you did. You broke your car. I'm like, oh my God. He said, I'm gonna have to tow you back to Klamath Falls. And I'm thinking, oh, So I get out of the car and he goes, you're gonna have to ride with me. I'm thinking, oh God, oh God. I go around to the other side of his truck and he opens the door and the inside of the truck looks just like that man. It's torn up and it's all greasy and dirty. And I'm like, oh, oh my goodness. And I turned around and I said to the Lord, today, don't let me lose my testimony, because I can tell I could lose my testimony today. I was really having a hard time. I get in this clunking machine that's filthy dirty with this man, and he's towing us back to Klamath Falls, which is going to take about 2 hours because the truck doesn't go over 50 miles an hour. And so he's driving along, clunking along. And he turns to me and he said, you seen those guys? And I said, what guys? And he says, you know, those guys, they go out for a loaf of bread and they never come home. And I thought, oh, for Pete's sake, there is a man in there and I'm going to find him. That's what I decided. So I said to him, you ever go fishing around here? You know, this is my husband's favorite fishing grounds. It's Williamson River. He just loves it. Oh, yeah, I fish. I go fishing all the time. I caught fish over here, and I've been over to this creek, and I caught most over there. And he started telling me all his fishing stories. And pretty soon he was done, and I went, wow, you've done a lot of fishing. There was a quiet lull for a moment. And then I said, you know, it gets really icy up here on this pass. You find yourself pulling a lot of people out of the ditch? Do you, you know, he goes, oh, yeah. And he said, and I'm going to tell you, they're so ungrateful. I said, really? People are ungrateful? He goes, yeah, think about this. One day a woman called me to come pull her out of the ditch because she was driving too fast. She spun out. Well, it turned out it was quite a slick spot because there were four other cars that spun out behind her. I had to move each one of those cars out of the ditch just to get to her. And then I pull her out of the ditch and I tell her how much it's going to cost her. She tells me to go fuck myself and she drives off. She doesn't care that this cost me. These people, I pulled four cars out of the ditch and none of them paid me. They're rude and they're obnoxious and they're mean-spirited. And all of a sudden I looked at him, I just thought, wow, that's not good treatment. You haven't been treated well. I said, you got any family? He goes, no, I don't, but there's a woman that I raised. She lives in Bend, and he tells me about his stepdaughter and how he loves her because she's always been his daughter. And so we just have this talk. We pull into the station, the car lot where my car is being towed to, and we walk up to the counter. And the man at the counter looks at me, and he looks at this little man, who, by the way, was shorter than me. And then he looks at me, and he looks at him, and he looks at me, and he goes, ma'am, are you okay? I went, oh, yeah, I'm just fine. We just need this car fixed. And he looks at the little man. He goes, take it out back. Take that car out back. You know where to put it. And he goes, all right. And the little man walks off and he gets in his truck and he tows it back to the back. I get the paperwork all done. And the man at the counter is going to walk me back to my car to get some of my things out while my husband's on his way to pick me up. And so I go back to the car and that little man is standing by the car. And that mechanic guy, he looked at him and said, what are you doing here? And that little man, he said, you know, I don't want to leave her. I don't want to leave that woman. He goes, go ahead, get on out of here. And I said, thank you so much for your help. But the next day I'm driving home in my husband's car while mine's being fixed. And I get to the top of the hill again, and I see the shop where that man works. And as I'm driving by, the Lord speaks to me, and he says, go say thank you to the nice man. I went, okay. So I stop. I go in his shop. I open the door, and I said, I just want to say thank you. And he looked at me. He goes, Teresa, I didn't think I'd ever see you again. And I said, well, I don't think I properly said thank you to you. And I just wanted to thank you for taking me into Klamath Falls. And he said, well, ma'am, that's my pleasure. It was great to meet you. You have restored my faith in humanity because somebody cares. And I said, well, listen, I would like to pray for you if you don't mind. And he just gets these tears in his eyes and he goes, you're going to pray for me? And I said, if you'd like me to, I will. And I put my hand out and he took that greasy, glommy little black hand and he put it in mine. And I put my other hand over the top of his hand. And I asked God to bless him and heal him and restore back what has been stolen from him. And I asked him to take all those words and all the painful rejection that this man has known in his lifetime and to heal him. I look up from my prayer and tears are just streaming down this man's face. As he is just astounded that I'm praying for him. And he said, today you made me feel so valuable. And he said, can I buy you coffee next time you come through? And I went, oh yeah, I'll give you one of my cards and you'll have my number. And if you need anything, you just call me. I hand him my card. It says executive director. He looks at me. Oh my goodness, I'm not important. And I said, you are so important to me. That day, keeping my testimony meant salvation. And I didn't know it. It was kind of scary, to be honest with you. A lot of things happen out on those roads. I wanted to be so angry that my car was breaking down because I only drive cars that won't break down because I don't want to break down. It cost me over $1,000 and I was really mad about that. But what was my mad going to do for me in that situation? And how that would have changed what happened if I would have allowed the anger to take over, which most of us women can do. We can get pretty snooty, snotty about things that are going on. My husband was so concerned about me being in a truck with this man. He's like, let me come and get you. I'll drive for hours to come and get you. Don't get in that truck. And I was like, no, I think I might be on assignment. So I asked God to not let me lose my testimony. What's very interesting is 2 years later, talking to Mike Cheney over there in Prineville, and we were having a little conference. I shared this story at that conference, and there was a man there who lived in Chemult, and he said, do you know what happened to that man? And I said, no, I don't know what happened to the man. And he said, well, just a few months ago, he went and pulled someone out of the ditch. And when he asked for the money, the guy shot him in the face. I'm like, oh my God. That's what happened to that man. So you don't know why you're put in these circumstances that you want to be mad about, you want to have attitude about it, you want to get upset, but you don't know what your assignment is right there. And so don't let anger take over your life. Don't let anger be the thing that keeps you from having a good testimony about the work of God in your life and in other people's lives. That's all I got, folks. What do you want to share about tonight? What was helpful?
I just know I have a lot to learn.
Don't we all? Don't we all? That'll always be true, you know. What else? What are your thoughts? Yeah, Lorna.
I'm thinking about expectations. There was a time when I realized I had all these expectations about what my life should look like. And it's like, it doesn't ever work out that way. But having the expectations means that, you know, you have a right to things, and then you get mad about not having what is your right to have, and you get yourself into a real pit if you're not careful. And there were a lot of expectations that I had that I didn't even realize I had, and somebody in counseling was asking me, well, do you think this? And it's like, yeah. And it's like, it didn't, unless they asked, I wouldn't have come up with that on my own. If somebody had said, what are your expectations? I wouldn't have never listed some things that they asked.
Yeah.
It's like the beginning of the anger and the bitterness.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. We've all had our battles, haven't we?
Yeah.
Anybody else? Any thoughts? What are you taking away from tonight?
I like the part about the expectations too, and just being kind of self-reflective, taking accountability of where I'm at, and am I where I want to be now? And just all of it was good tonight. All of it. Thank you.
Oh, good. I'm glad it was helpful.
Very.
Lisa, I really appreciate you sharing with us the four steps that you did with Patrick. I know the seven steps. I just really appreciated that. It was really beautiful, and it just gives me a lot to ponder, because we've gone through really horrendous financial stress over the years, and we didn't always handle it well. But I realized that we could have handled it so much worse. So I'm just thankful to be able to be in that place where I'm not so wounded that I can't help someone else.
Yeah.
Thank you for tonight.
You're welcome. Thank you, Frida. You got another story for your book there. Anybody else before we close? What are you taking away?
I really appreciated the man and woman in the box. I think it really helps to have something graphic to look at. It just, sometimes we can talk and talk and talk and the words just need to multiply, but that kind of, and some people understand things better if they're pictorial.
Yeah, that's
true. But one thing that occurred to me is that we can often have maybe a good understanding, you know, just that you shouldn't have a box and that you shouldn't have expectations. And you maybe have a healthy idea of what your role should be as a wife, mother, parent, whatever, until a crisis comes along. And then you get shaken and you have to reevaluate, and the, you know, like somebody loses a job or gets fired or demoted, or your kids do something that get them in serious trouble, or, you know, and so much of our values are deep inside of us. And it's these crises that really draw out where the problem areas are. But when you're in the thick of it, you don't think about the work God is trying to do, the refining work in you, and you just feel the pain and the disillusionment.
Thank you. Melanie, did you have something?
Yes, I really appreciated the drama triangle. Uh-huh. At first, I thought you said trauma triangle. Then halfway through, I was like, oh, she said drama.
Yeah, drama.
Yeah. So I knew part of the information, but just having you explain the whole thing, I was like, yes, okay. That's very, very meaningful.
Good. That's great. Are we ready to close tonight then, or do you have anything else? Yeah, Lorna.
I am in a lot of pain. I seem to have wrenched my neck and back. And so I would like prayer for how this gets fixed.
What are you going to do to fix this?
Yeah, what are you going to do to fix this? And it's too bad that I'm a long way away from Melanie, because I imagine that she could help a lot. But here I am in Coquille, where it's beautiful, but I don't know any doctors or massage therapists or anybody.
I'll teach you to move away from home, Lorna.
Yeah. There's things you miss.
All right, let's go ahead and close. We'll just say, Father God, we thank you so much. You have so much to show us and to teach us. You have so much to say to us. And I pray that the ears of our heart, the spiritual ears of our heart, will be open to hear the voice of the Spirit. That when you want to speak to us, we can hear you. And that we, Father God, can follow in your footsteps and do the things that you direct us to do. Thank you for each person who came tonight and those who couldn't. We just bless each home, each family, and ask you to continue to grow us up in all spiritual truth, wisdom, and knowledge until we are complete in Christ Jesus. We give thanks for one another. Thanks for your Spirit among us. And thanks, Father God, that you are with us when we get to be with you. Go with each one in the mighty name of Jesus and keep us safe. Amen. Good night, everybody. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Teresa.
Great evening. Thank you, Teresa.
You're welcome. Love it. Love you guys.
And Teresa, I'll send you a letter, an email about everything before the 29th.
Okay, thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Well, I'm very appreciative that you're willing to be a part of it. Wow.
Yes, I wouldn't miss it.
Oh, wow. Well, I'm going to kind of try to set an agenda with Fred and then we'll just see how it goes.
Sounds good. Thanks. Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.